was only one novelist in the world today whose face is as well known to the general public as the titles of their books, and perhaps even better known than the actual contents of those books. That novelist is, of course, Miss Jacqueline Susann. Miss Susann, hello.
Hello, Miss Grand, but please call me Jacqueline.
All right, Jacqueline. There is no doubt that you've just pulled off a literary hat trick. Three best sellers in a row. That's true, isn't it? First there was Valley of the Dolls,
then Love Machine, and now Once Is Not Enough. But the big literary thing that they said made publishing history was that there's never been any author, male or female. This sounds very immodest of me to say it.
I'm sure you are very immodest.
That made number one three times in a row, not just been on the bestseller list. Number one.
I think we should clarify that, because Once Is Not Enough was just published yesterday, so it can't be a bestseller.
Well, I'm talking about the States.
England, yeah.
Well, I'm talking about the States.
Yeah. Do you take it for granted it will be a bestseller here?
No. I never take anything for granted. Not even my husband.
Do you take it for granted that you'll write bestsellers? I know nobody sets out to write a bad seller. You don't sit down at a typewriter and say, I'm going to write the worst book in the world.
You really can't tell it's going to be a bestseller, because, for example, if I did know, each book has taken longer. Like my first book, which will always be my favorite, is Every Night Josephine About My Poodle. And in the States, that made like eighth or ninth place with my first book, and it was a light bestseller. And then Valley of the Dolls took two, and that took 9 months to write. Valley of the Dolls took 2 years to write. Love Machine took three, and Once Is Not Enough took 3.5. Because each time you write, you demand more of yourself. You pull more of yourself out. You say, oh, there must be another way to say that line. And if you knew it was going to be a hit, you'd turn out one every year if you had an idea of what was going to be a hit.
You say you're demanding more of yourself.
Right.
Why? Is it because the critics have been so cruel? I don't know anybody who's been so savaged by critics as you have.
They got very upset when I got reviews like poetry over Every Night Josephine. Then they were outraged that a woman would write a book treating sex like a man. And I was sort of slaughtered. And then they were more outraged that the book, it will go in Guinness's record this time, as it says, replacing Peyton Place as the biggest selling novel in all time. Now they said, well, she could only write women. And then I came out with Love Machine, and the male protagonist, Robin Stone, was the lead. And they had to admit, they weren't quite so rotten. They were, some of them said, she's doing, this is, was a very interesting theme. With this, I've gotten raves in the States. I mean, Rex Reed said it's the best book I've ever written. Joyce Haber, Barbara Bannon in the Publishers Weekly said it.
This is important to you.
No.
It isn't.
I'm pleased. But when I write not for 7 or 8 critics. We have books that 7 or 8 critics have given rave reviews, and they sell 800 copies. To me, a writer's greatest thing is communication with the public. And I'm only interested in the public. If they are turned on by my book, then I consider it a success. I don't keep a scrapbook of literary criticism.
Doesn't it ever hurt you? You must have a very, either a very small psyche or a very tough psyche, not to be hurt by the slashing things that have been said about you.
No, I only get upset sometimes when there's been when it gets personal.
Are you tough? That's what I'm asking you. You have the reputation, everything I've read about you, tough, cynical Jackie Susann. You know what I mean.
I'm not tough at all. I think they regard, they mix a novelist with a novel. In other words, if I'm writing about a tough, cynical lady, they say she must be tough. But if I did all the things that my heroines did in my books, I'd be in a glass jar at Harvard on display. No, I'm not. I'm very emotional. But I learned right away that when Valley of the Dolls came out, a good friend of mine said, you must look this way, and you must not read what anyone says about you, because in America, we don't have royalty. So we build superstars, whether it's Jacqueline Onassis or whether it's Elizabeth Taylor. And once we get them up there, or whether it's Jacqueline Susann, then we throw rocks at them because we say, how dare they be tremendous or any bigger than we are? We put them there. Now let's hack them down throw rocks at them.
But the rocks bounced off you.
Oh, well, that's only because I have a marvelous husband named Irving Mansfield who said, you sold 7,000 copies this week, and this person who wrote this thing about you wrote The Life of the Tsetse Fly, which sold 800 copies during the whole run. What are you worried about?
I think perhaps part of the resentment from the literary establishment comes from the fact that you and your husband Irving have set yourselves up as a selling company, and I'm not so sure which is the bestseller, I'll tell you truthfully, whether your books are bestsellers or whether you and your husband are the best sellers of books. Do you see what I mean?
Well,
which is the product, you or the book?
Way back, the author always sold, the successful author sold himself, only we didn't have the media.
Yeah.
If you recall, Ernest Hemingway would always, there was always great publicity, how he was a great white hunter, how he went to the bull ring, how he did all these things, and so that you sort of almost mixed the man with his character, and they said, that's really Hemingway. F. Scott Fitzgerald, he and his wife Zelda, lived the same kind of flamboyant life in the south of France as the kind of Americans they wrote about. And then along came television and the shrinkage of our own American newspapers. We only have a city like New York has three newspapers, and they're not national, and each city has their own newspapers. But what is national is television. And we have like 10 channels. Now, what happened was that most authors were authors who wrote, and they would get to television, they'd go, yes, yes, ma'am, yes. Whereas I was an actress before. So when I came on, I felt perfectly at ease with the camera. And therefore, it was
You're enjoying this.
I feel like I'm with you. We're both sort of dishing, as we say in the States, and I forget all about cameras.
But then that gives you an extra a head start,
right,
doesn't it?
Right, so it doesn't mean that Irving and I have gone out and sold the thing.
Well,
it's because I'm sitting here talking to you and I'm enjoying you, rather than I'm saying, yes, ma'am.
Yes, but you're sitting here talking to me because you do want to sell even more copies of your books.
Well, of course.
Let's be honest.
When anybody writes a book, you don't want it to be just put in the closet. You want to sell it. I mean, when anyone does anything, they want it to be good. You are on television. You want people to see your show and watch you more than someone else. We all want to do the best. We must try to do the best.
Now, you said communication was your real motive, and obviously, after you'd written Valley of the Dolls, as far as money went, you could have retired
right.
and just sat in your behind, couldn't you?
Oh, I could have had a marvelous time.
As a working journalist, I do not understand anybody who writes unless they have to for money. Can't understand it. It's weird to me.
It's a terrible thing. I think, why do I do it? And after Valley of the Dolls, when Love Machine made number one, everyone said, well, now quit. Quit while you're ahead. You've had three books out. They've all been bestsellers. You've had two number ones. You've proven everything you set to prove out. I said, no, because I have a funny belief in God in this way, that if God gives you a certain talent, whether it's big or little, you must work at it because he's given this to you. And if you don't, you'll be punished. And each day I feel we must earn the right to live. Whether if you're not a writer or if you don't have talent, you earn it as a mother, being a good mother to your children, or a good wife to your husband, or a good daughter to your mother. In some way, we cannot just live a sybaritic life or be complete hedonists.
You're punishing yourself.
No, I'm earning the right to be able to play poker or play golf or do something that is completely something I adore doing.
Now, what I meant when I said you're punishing yourself, there was almost something Puritan what you said, that God would be angry at you if you didn't do something hard and torturous, your work.
Well, my father...
Is this a very personal God that you've got?
Oh, yes.
Do you talk to him?
Oh, yes. We have big conversations and arguments. Oh, yes. I say, how could you do this to me? When something goes wrong, I say, haven't I always been very nice? And haven't I always thanked you for all the good and prayed for other people as well as for my, you know?
You know, I see headlines, the high priestess of sex, the sexiest novelist in the world. I mean, Jacqueline Susann is almost a dirty name now, and you're talking about God talking to you. Does that make any sense?
Yes, because we are many things to many people. And to some people, I am the Dr. Spock of poodles, of animals, because of Josephine.
But do you think you are the sexiest novelist in the world? Do you think you're the high priestess of sex? I think it's all nonsense.
Of course not, because what is sexy to someone is not sexy to another. And there have been books and books written about sex with really hard porno, and they don't sell.
Your books are not pornographic at all.
No,
in fact,
not.
The sex in your books is always very disappointing and unfulfilling for both parties, isn't it?
Well, usually when it's just sex for sex sake, it like in Once Is Not Enough, where January Wayne, the heroine, finds out that being a virgin is sort of not something wonderful to be in the set that she meets. She just gives it away, and that's when I describe it, because it's a very bad experience. But when it's great, all you have to say, and he took her in his arms and it was good, and everybody, and you don't have to be explicit, because then it's part of love. To me, sex should start here and here with a woman, and it usually does. And when there is sex without love, it can be very ugly and bad.
Well, following the pattern of your books, it seems to me you've become increasingly unenchanted, or disenchanted, I should say, with permissiveness. I know I'm taking one of the characters in your book, not what you yourself have said, when you said, I've taken a look at this permissive world, and in my book it stinks. That's what Mike says in Once Is Not Enough. And I think it's you talking.
Well, then, on the other hand, I'm also talking for Linda, who, you know, says, I want a relationship with a man, but I don't want to get married, where deep down she does. Women's lib, I think, is absolutely marvelous in that women should get paid the same amount as men if they're doing a man's job. If a woman is a camera woman, she should get the same amount as a man who's a cameraman. If she is a good newscaster, she should get the same amount of money, no matter what she does. But on the other hand, there is a complete difference between men and women. And when women say, a man is a male chauvinist pig, that's ridiculous. I mean, our last tennis match with Billie Jean and Bobby Riggs proved that whoever is better player has nothing to do with man or woman. She was a better player and she was younger, and she could go all over the court. But I do believe that men can have sexual experiences without being emotionally involved, whereas women, really, a real woman can't. And the women who pretend to or try to do that. I mean, this has gone back, way back to men going out in wars and having women being sent along, and the woman that he's married to waiting at home with the chastity belt. But it's always been proven that men need women, whereas a woman needs a man in a different way.
Your women, though, your heroines are exploited by men. They're destroyed by men.
But some of them aren't. For example, in Love Machine, Maggie, when Robin Stone finally said, all right, I'll marry you, she said, no, not unless you say you need me.
Yes, but she'd spent years waiting for the guy to ask her to marry
him. But she wasn't exactly sitting around. She was doing a lot of things that she really didn't approve of. In this book, January is not exploited by men. She is... She's licked in the beginning
but
before all, she starts.
All your women live their lives around and within the idea of being sexually attractive to men. That is their basic aim in life.
But there are so many women that I have met that is their basic aim. That they are, you look at all the magazines and you see eyelashes that will make your eyes bigger. You see creams that will make your face better for him. Why are we doing it? We're not doing it for other women. You see, everything hairstyles for him, to make you more alluring, dresses. Whereas the man, it's, well, hairspray so it doesn't get her, or something that doesn't get her mess
but
up.
And you don't think this is exploitation?
Well, only because, no, we are women. And it's a wonderful thing to be. It's a wonderful thing that we want to use hand cream.
But some of your, not heroines, but some of the leading female characters in your books are sort of admirable artifacts. They've got silicone in their bosoms, they've got false hair hanging down here, they've got scars there, scars in their thighs. And you write about them with admiration because they fought off age.
Well, no, I don't. You see, I don't go along that way. I say there is this kind of woman. On the other hand,
but you admire them because they're fighting against something inevitable.
I give them points.
Points.
I give them points, but that doesn't mean I necessarily want to do that. I write about how. To me, it's sad. I showed in Judith in the other book, The Love Machine, how when she went through all of this body lift, and Robin never even noticed it, or he never even looked at her, that when there is real love, with Carla, character in this book, who, when she is in love with David, it doesn't matter whether she has silicone here or whether she's flat. He loves her. He is completely enamored of Carla, here, everywhere. And he even says he doesn't care that she's older than he is.
But you, in your books, there seems to be a certain rage about the fact that men at the age of 53 can marry a girl of 21.
But that's
considered
so true.
Great, whereas if a woman of 53 married a boy.
Well, I'll give you a great example. Cary Grant, when he was...
All right, given to me now.
Right, when he's 69 years old now. When Cary Grant was like 63, he married a girl in her 20s. And everyone said how lucky Diane Cannon was to get Cary Grant. What would happen if a woman of 63 married a man in his 20s? No one would say, isn't he lucky to get her?
But this is, again, what I'm saying
and
about
I show that
your
in my book.
Anger about the fact that women age in a different way.
Yes,
than men
you see,
do.
We a man like Spencer Tracy got wrinkles. And everything. Sir Laurence Olivier is magnificent with every new line he gets. And I've heard men say about a woman, oh, that even here in London, that bird's got mileage on her. She's 25 years old, I'll bet. I've heard it. And you see, that is the thing that women are subjected to. And I'm very lucky because I have the most marvelous husband in the world who sometimes in the morning when I haven't put any makeup on, we'll say, come on, it's a great day, let's go for a walk. And I said, wait till I put my face on. He said, well, you look marvelous to me. I look no different to him with or without makeup.
I think that your life as a woman is a peculiar one to me because you've never had a home.
Oh, yes, I have.
Well, you live in a hotel, don't
no,
you?
No, I don't. You see, that's
but you say you've never cooked.
But I do. You see,
what's all this phony publicity I've been getting then?
I'll tell you, I did live in a hotel. Because my husband preferred it. His business was, when we first got married, we were going to have the maid, or I was going to cook and do all the things. And there was no, he was a television producer, radio producer, and there was no, he called me suddenly, and I had gone to such things to try to get the steaks ready and everything in the salad, and he'd say, far away, we have to meet, so forth, and the star is going to be in the show, and we're meeting 8 o'clock at 21. And so then he said, look, we've got to live in a hotel because there is no dinner hour. So I had never learned to really cook because you learn from your mom. And my mother was a school teacher. And so the maid was always throwing me out of the kitchen. And then when we lived in a hotel for a while, a great deal of time, and we spent so much time in Beverly Hills. And as I said to everyone, there's no point in taking a house because what I need would be a wife. Because he's working and I'm working, and who would be telling someone what to do? So it was much easier in a hotel. And this last few years, we've had an apartment, and I've learned to make steaks, and I make the greatest hamburger in the world, and meatloaf, I'm sensational at.
Give me the recipe later.
I will, and I love to cook. And I was like, I worked real hard to get the apartment. You know, I'm very proud of it, and. I've even learned about what kind of furniture polish you use. I've got a housekeeper, and together I say, Louise, did you see that commercial? Should we try this? And
you're happy about this?
Oh, I love it. And I wish, and I have a son, but I don't bring my personal life out in interviews because I feel that people should, if they want to think of me as a high priestess of sex, if that sells books, that's all. Let them think what they want.
Sure.
My friends know what I am.
But you see, in your books, and I've read them very, very carefully, I feel that you despise, with a certain underlying compassion, the people that you're writing about, the society you're writing about.
Oh, I despise the society.
But you're a part of it. How can you be happy within that society in which you live?
People think that when I write these books, like this is about spiritual and mental incest between a girl and her
father.
The
newest book, yes.
And about David's hang up on Carla, and about Mike being married to the sixth richest woman in the world, that they think, oh, she must think this is marvelous. I show the tragedy, that none of these people are really happy. And the only way to change it, it's like Gustave Flaubert, when he wrote Madame Bovary, he was sued because they said there were prurient passages in his books. And to paraphrase what his lawyer said, he said, sometimes it is necessary to depict vice to promote virtue.
You're having your cake and eating it, and you're saying that you are titillating the public with some sex, but you are a moralist? You yourself are a moralist?
I'm a moralist in this way, that I am saying this is the way it is, and these are the things I see. And I remember after Valley of the Dolls, I had young girls come to me and say, after reading your book, I'll never even take an aspirin. Well, that's marvelous. I've had other girls say to me, after reading that, I was going to go to New York, but I married Fred and stayed in my own hometown. Once is not enough, I had several girls come to me and say, you know, I was going with this man, he was in his late 40s. I was so much in love with him, and I've given him 7 years of my life. And we couldn't get married for the first 4 years because he's divorced, but he wanted to wait till his daughter got out of high school. Now we're waiting till she gets out of college. Then I know it was going to be till she gets married. And suddenly I realized from your book, he's more hung up on his daughter than he is on me.
Now, you've said that people immediately relate you to the main characters of your book.
Yes.
Valley of the Dolls. Did you take drugs yourself?
No.
Ever?
Well, would I be here?
One dedicated to your father,
yes.
About a girl's intense love for her father.
I said to Robert Susann, my father,
yeah.
Who would understand, and to Irving Mansfield, who does understand.
Can I ask you a question? Because you asked me this question a couple of days ago, and I answered it very, very flippantly. Mm-hmm. And you said to me, we were talking about your books, you said, look, if somebody came up to you and said, you've got 6 weeks to live, how would you want to change your life? Mm-hmm. Intensify certain areas, expand them? And I had no answer. I'm asking you that question now. You threw me on the spot, so I'll do the same to you.
I think I'd go right on doing what I was doing, and I'd have a big argument with God and say, how about giving me 12 more, and why? And I would say, I'm not going to only have 6 weeks to live. I'm going to make it longer, and you're going to help me. I would accept the impossible. Instead of saying why, I'd say why not.
Mrs. Susann, thank you very, very much for being with us today.
Thank you.